Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Respawn Plays. Today we are going to be going through effect and cause, what internally was called Time Shift. That's which true. I always thought was, and I think we still call it that all the time. So we may refer to this mission as Time Shift a few times in these videos. We're talking about effect and cause. I am Jay Frechette, and I am the community manager here at Respawn.
I'm Sean Wilson, senior animator, and I did some of the animations for BT and the Creatures.
I'm Jake Keating, senior designer, and I did the design, geometry layout, and scripting for this mission.
Manny Hagopian, I'm one of the writers.
All right, let's get to it. I remember when I first started here, and I was first playing through this the single-player campaign, and I didn't have a lot of context to it. I'd been going dark on Titanfall 2, and everybody internally was like, have you played Time Shift yet? Have you played Time Shift yet? Have you played Time Shift yet?
You should have been there in the very beginning. I remember when Jake first prototyped this as an action block, and I was like, yes, I want this right now. He, back then, like, he was able to capture this eerie, spooky vibe to it. So I was pretty happy that he carried that through for the final one.
Yeah, like Beacon, this one kind of started as a what we called our action block phase. And we were doing just quick prototypes of gameplay ideas. And this one started off as just a pitch I actually did years ago, before we even had Titans and Pilots, and then resurrected it when we finally decided to do a single-player mission. And we were all doing these crazy action block ideas, and I took an old map that I did corporate and made a dirty version of it, and did some gags with time travel, and people dug it, and then we just kind of ran with it.
How are you accomplishing this technically, switching in between like that?
Yeah, it actually ends up being a lot easier than a lot of people think it is. People have theorized kind of online how it's done with texture swapping and stuff like that, but essentially it ended up being building one level on top of the other in the same map. And you would essentially just tell it, you'd have a clean version on the top and the dirty version on the bottom. And anytime the player pressed the button, or anytime you had these scripted shifts, I'm literally just teleporting the player to the other level.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's a big level.
Two levels.
That was my favorite part, is seeing just people's reactions when they first go from one time period to the other. And we got to see that in some Twitch streams and stuff. Every time it happens for the first time, it's like they're expressions of, oh my gosh, I did not see that coming.
Right.
What just happened? And then the idea after it is, what just happened, BT? It's like,
that's awesome. Yeah, this must have been a fun area to sort of play around with storytelling. Cool opportunities here, right?
It was so much like the the nature of the mechanic of it being able to time travel. So it was so cool. And then on top of it, it was slow paced and calm, so that balance between the two gave us the opportunity to kind of throw in a lot of exposition and story and stuff like that as we were going through. Like earlier, we got to see Martyr doing his speech and stuff like that, and could find the opportunity, especially in the Titanfall universe, of like fast paced, constantly running, climbing on walls. And this was the, all right, we get to take a breath and look around. Freak out.
Yeah, and even like piggybacking on that, like, we're always seeing Jack and BT constantly murdering people and robots, so it was actually nice to see them in a more quieter, calm setting.
Because everyone's already dead.
This scene, actually, I think it was my second or third time the game before I really appreciated this. This BT is just walking around checking all the corpses to get information. That's just it's a really cool. He's just down to business all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sean had some, we spent a lot of time on this section, just going back and forth, like trying to figure out how to, make it feel like a wild environment. I mean, the whole first part of the level is kind of meant to make you feel sort of unsteady and unsafe. And so it's no accident that we just ended up having literally monsters coming out and jump scaring you. Just dead people and creepiness and that whole vibe. Because later you contrast it with just being a time god when you get the device. So kind of meant to feel underpowered here.
I remember it being sort of difficult to find Anderson for some people. I remember going through different renditions of like, how come no one can see this body hanging from the ceiling?
You've already seen a lot of weird stuff up to here, so it's like maybe not just like, as weird.
Yeah, it's no accident that his helmet is blinking brightly, right. And there's sparks coming out of it to just say, hey, look up here.
The giant red light on him.
Just a big arrow with neon saying, like, please look up here.
But that was one of the story ideas of, like, wanting to build up the idea that we have to go meet Anderson. Meet Anderson. Like, this guy made it through all this stuff alone. You hear, like, earlier in levels, grunts talking about, like just a pilot had gone through at times, stuff like that. And then you go meet him, and he's dead, stuck in a wall. It's, like, such a downer. But it makes you feel cooler. Like, oh, I'm better than this guy.
Yep. Absolutely.
With the death of Anderson. Yeah, there's a lot of Sean's animations giving BT some personality. Did you mocap these as BT, or did you hand animate?
Not, yeah. I suited up and just pretended I was a giant killing machine robot.
You are a giant machine. What are you talking about?
After pretending. Some coffee in the morning, I think, yeah. That's pretty much it. Uh-huh.
Yeah, this part coming up when he throws a lamppost as a javelin, and yeah, that's kind of like interesting because originally we had him fastball, doing a fastball special like in Beacon, because Beacon came before this in some level order, and so he was going to fastball special you up through the hole, and then we realized like, no, he can't do that. That's Beacon's. We're stealing Beacon's thunder, so he has to do something else. So Sean and I put our heads together and had him.
Yeah, and just seeing BT interact with the environment, I think, adds personality in its own when he's not killing other things. And I do like the fact that, like, you guys threw in when he's mentioning about throwing you next time. It's like,
yeah, no, foreshadowing.
Yeah, like, that was perfect.
Then he knows next time he's going to throw you.
I'm glad this is how that's actually how that played out. That's super interesting because this is one of my favorite animation vignettes. Like,
yeah, this good is sense so of cool.
It looks awesome. I love how he points first.
Yeah.
Did you mocap that one?
What were you carrying? Nice. Like, yeah, because it looked very heavy.
Air. I didn't.
Air. Anything, yeah. You're not holding anything.
Heavy
with mocap.
Air.
Yeah. Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. So there, he just did the little foreshadowing of saying, "Yeah, well, I'll keep that in mind. Maybe I'll throw it next time."
The first
time playing through, you don't really think anything of it. It's kind of flowing along.
Yep.
Bunch of little hidden things.
Man, it's so fun to watch designers play through this because I'm like, oh, that's there?
Yeah. The helmet up there, too.
Right? There used to be.
I think I accidentally got one once.
One of our lead animators, Paul, came up with a view for this section. I thought this was pretty cool. It's like adding to the whole eerie, unsettling vibe.
Yeah, it ended up, you know, getting overwhelmed by a bunch of zombie robots. It got fitting pretty well, but it's funny, it's once you've so many iterations, it's like in the Beacon video, it's like you spend enough time iterating on something and it
eventually becomes good somewhat. But this started as when you first came to campus, there was just dead specters lying all over the place, and you had to come to this building to restore automated security. And then go back outside and sort of like Pied Piper them to a door scanner. It was this real ham-fisted, poorly designed puzzle that I came up with initially, and then it kind of morphed into this just because the sheer amount of time that we spent on this on this mission.
I love how the past really affects the future in some manner. Like, because we were in the past and like those specters, stalkers saw us, like they are now activated in the present.
Yeah.
And you talk about that in foreshadowing. You set up you put in a lot of foreshadowing of like the elevators and stuff like that. Like, log of saying like someone just took out all those people at the elevator.
Yeah.
It's like that happens. So I love how it connects, how you made it really connect really well.
Yeah, and then those guys on the ground there, those skeletonized soldiers, that's just an example of every department just chipping in and sort of, you know, saying, okay, you're going to just use these for this one little section where you see dead bodies or skeletonized prowlers or, you know, all these custom assets for these levels that people just said, yeah, sure, we'll do it.
Yeah,
you know,
even like
I'm going to be in this one level.
Even like,
just kind of like, you better not screw this up.
Art model shop, like, pulled through and, like, got you the flyer at the last second before it was cut.
That's true. Absolutely. Absolutely. So, yeah, it's
good. That was 9 minutes, huh? Boy, that first episode went by fast. Yeah. My goodness. So, yeah, that was our part one of Effect and Cause. Super interesting stuff, man. That was our first episode. I already felt like I learned a lot about this mission. Make sure to like and subscribe to our Respawn channel if you're liking what you see. Also, stay tuned and keep watching for part two.